We are now ready to continue in Romans chapter 12. After the lengthy discussion of the first two verses, we will move a little faster through the rest of the chapter. Let me first of all say, in regard to the whole chapter, I think that the first two verses, you could say, regard the believer, you, and God. And then verses 3 through about 16, I think, are generally regarding you and me. That is, you and other Christians, the body of Christ. And then chapter 12, the last six verses or so, 17 to 21, expand to the next larger sphere of life, which is you and society, or the world, or unbelievers. And you can see the what you might call concentric progression there of, first of all, you and God, your relationship, you and God, the Lord Jesus Christ. Then we reach out to others in the body of Christ and practice loving them. And then together we reach out to the world and show them God's heart. So we'll begin with verse 3, and it says, "For by the grace given me, I say to every one of you." You can see the humility that Paul manifests throughout the epistles that he writes. And remember all that we talked about in the first couple tapes on Paul, and how he was so thankful for what God had done, and how he saw so vividly how God had rescued him. Maybe his life was so blatantly evil before he realized, that he realized that, and it was easier for him to see how far he had come. But really, he was no more dead in trespasses and sins than any other body and soul man who is maybe a good Joe. So he goes on here and he says, "Do not think of yourself more highly than you ought, but rather think of yourself with sober judgment." The King James says, "Think soberly." The word is sophroneo, means to think whole thoughts. And it indicates, according to Welch, made this statement, that quality of mind or inclination arising out of the condition of being saved. In other words, the same principle that we've seen throughout. Now we are saved, let's act like it. Think of yourself according to thoughts pertinent to salvation, you might say. Sophroneo. Sozo is the word for save, and so you have the beginning of that word with thoughts. In accordance with the measure of faith God has given you. Now, here is an important point, because it talks about the measure of faith God has given you. Well, we've already read in chapter 10, for example, that faith is a result of hearing, and that faith is a response on the part of an individual to the truth of God's word. So what does it mean here, that the faith that God has given? Let's keep our marker here and turn to Acts 17:31. Acts chapter 17, verse 31. Acts 17, 31, Paul is ending his great speech, or sharing, whatever you want to call it, on Mars Hill to the great brains of Greece in Athens there. And it says, "For he, God, has set a day when he will judge the world with justice by the man whom he has appointed," by the man he has appointed, and of course that's Jesus Christ. "He has given proof of this to all men by raising him from the dead." The King James reads, "Whereof he has given assurance unto all men, in that he has raised him from the dead." The word assurance in the King James, or the word proof here, is the Greek word pistis, which means faith. So the question is, how has God given faith to all men? And I think the answer is by giving them something to have faith in, that is, the Lord Jesus Christ. And I think it's the figure of speech, metonymy, one noun put for another where those two nouns are related. It isn't God who, as far as I see the Bible, who gives faith. He gives you some faith and he gives somebody else more faith and all. No. Faith oxanos. Faith grows. 2 Corinthians 10:15. You can see that. And so this verse, I think, makes it plain and helps us to understand. Go back to Romans 12, please. What Romans 12:3 is talking about. Now, because look, rather think of yourself with sober judgment, or to think whole thoughts. Now, what is the standard for whole thoughts? What is the standard for thinking whole thoughts? God's written word. And faith comes by hearing. And I think it's plain that what this is saying is that we think according to the measure of faith God has given us, according to the word he's given us, whereby we can have faith. Then come verse 4 and 5. Now you'll see how the first part of verse 3, it says, do not think of yourself more highly than you ought to think. Then it says, in essence, the second part of the verse, but think according to God's word. Think according to God's word. Now, you'll see why it says, don't think more highly. Look at verses 4 and 5. Just as each of us has one body with many members, talking about our physical body, and these members do not all have the same function, we know that. So, in Christ, we who are many form one body. This is the first mention in the church epistles of the one body of Christ. Of course, the great truth regarding this, that is, the mystery, is more specifically delineated in Ephesians, the next doctrinal epistle. But I think this is important to see here, that Paul had verbally been teaching the mystery, though Ephesians was not yet written. And I'll point that out to you again as we finish Romans here. We'll see it at the very end. There's a little sort of a blurb at the end of Romans about the mystery. And it says, I have fully taught the gospel. We'll see that. And I think that means that he has shared everything that God had revealed to him. And that was basically the pattern. It was shared verbally before it was written down. So, he says, so in Christ, we who are many form one body, and each member belongs to all the others. Verse 6. We have different gifts according to the grace given us. Now, this is great because the grace given us is equal, right? Yeah. And so we have different gifts according to the grace given us. I think of the Oklahoma land rush back in 18-something, 88 or something like that. And so they lined up all the wagons there, and everyone was in a line. In other words, all this great land was out in front of them. Everyone had equal access or an equal opportunity to have some land. And so they shot the gun, and everyone galloped off. And they then picked different plots of land and did different things with them. And that's how I look at this, because the word gifts is the word charisma. The same as we saw in Romans 1:11, remember? I long to see you, that I may impart unto you some spiritual gift. And this is the same way that it's used here. The way that I phrased it there, remember, was ways of utilizing the gift of Holy Spirit. So he says, with that Spirit, that is, in the body of Christ, We utilize Holy Spirit differently. Now, I can't articulate all the reasons behind this. Some of them may be genetic, the way that we qualities we had genetically inherited from our parents, or then experientially, the way we're raised, certain interests we have, certain long suits, you might call them. But then Holy Spirit is the key to our lives. It's the equalizing factor in the body of Christ. So it says, and the key here is different, not better. You see, grace puts no limits on anyone. You might think of grace as that condition which allows you to go farther than you ever thought possible. Grace puts no limits on anyone. Remember, we're in the, what law are we under? What's the speed limit? The law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus. You can, as they say, put the hammer down. So each of us does our best. Remember the parable of the talents? Well, those different abilities, and then they were utilized to the full, and each received a full reward and was blessed and fulfilled. And that's the way life is supposed to be in the body of Christ. Now then it goes on. If a man's gift is prophesying, now, if a man's gift is prophesying, that's a little misleading. I don't believe in the text the word gift is repeated there. And it looks like prophecy is a gift, like the gifts of the Spirit. And again, if you're not familiar with this, Introduction to God's Heart will cover 1 Corinthians 12, 13, and 14, every verse. We see that these are not gifts, they're manifestations. So you have seven functions. Functions. We saw that word in verse 4. All the members don't have the same function. And so we have a list here of seven different kinds of functions, different categories in which people with Holy Spirit will operate, you might say. So it says, if a man's gift is prophesying, in other words, if his thing, that which he's into, is prophecy, then let him use it in proportion to his faith. And I just told you, faith grows. Faith, oxano, means to grow. And so, as we utilize this gift of Holy Spirit and keep building God's Word in our lives and acting upon it by functioning in these categories, our faith is going to increase, so that we ought to become more proficient in these functions. Verse 7. If it is serving, well then let him serve. Get in there. That what it's saying is every single member in the body of Christ has a function or several functions that will fulfill him, and more importantly, which are vital to the overall functioning of the body of Christ. I need you functioning in the body of Christ. You need me functioning in the body of Christ. But you see, hierarchical organizations, Christian organizations, so squelch the individual initiative in believers that they end up as spiritual welfare cases. With just, what I mean is, they have the ability to function, but they just have been so conditioned to this mindset of, tell me what to think, tell me what to do, I can't function without some reverend somebody telling me something. And that is sad. Verse 7 goes on. Now, you see, in these seven functions, if you looked up the different Greek words used here, you would be able to get a little more scope on each of these things. Now, prophecy, we pretty much know what that is. Serving, that's the word diakonio. That's a great word. If you want to look at that, you'll see a whole lot of things that would relate to that. Then it says, if it is teaching, let him teach. Get in there and teach. How do you know what you like to do? Well, you got to try. And don't you like to do things that you're good at? Sure, you do. Well, how do you get good at something? By doing it. Then verse 8 says, if it is encouraging, that's that word parakaleo that we talked about. If it's encouraging, then let him encourage. Now, you could, again, look that word up to see what it means, but even what we talked about, you know, to call to one side, to speak any words necessary to exhort, admonish, comfort, or encourage to a more worthy endeavor. Well, do you know a person, or maybe you're this way, that it's just very easy to talk to? He always seems to know what to say to bless your life. I think that all of that is encompassed in this. These are functions of encouraging, they translate that. Well, we need the encouragement of one another. Then the next clause. If it is contributing to the needs of others, let him give generously. Now, not everyone will have the same ability to give. Remember, God looks on the heart. One penny from one person means the same to God as $1 million from another person. But not everyone has the resources to give $1 million or $1,000 or whatever. But some people, this will be their function or one of their functions in the body of Christ. You can see that. There were people who traveled with Jesus, Luke 8:1 and following, some wonderful women and others, and they ministered to him of their substance so that Jesus could be free to do what he wanted to do in ministering to people. Well, this is just common sense right here, and I know Christians have been ripped off by so-called ministers, preachers, and leaders and all this who have either laid a doctrine of the tithe on them and you have to give your 10% or something bad will happen to you, and then they've squandered a lot of the money or turned out to be not all that you thought they were, and certainly that discourages people and makes them suspicious. But you can see here that this is in the Bible, contributing to the needs of others. That doesn't mean only ministers. It means everyone in the body of Christ. You see, and minister, you see, that word means servant. Let's keep it straight. We've already seen there's no hierarchy. There's no clergy, laity, gulf. But there are people whose gift, so to speak, in this context, whose function, let's say it is, to minister God's word on a full-time basis. And so it is perfectly biblical to contribute to their needs, but not at the expense of your own needs, at least on a consistent basis. That doesn't mean you wouldn't sacrifice something sometime, but that doesn't mean you give what you need, your 10%, so you have no food. But you see, we help one another. That's why we need to be part of a local fellowship where we have the opportunity to share of our time, our material abundance with other brothers and sisters in the body of Christ. So it says, if this is your thing, give generously. If it's leadership, let him govern diligently. And that, again, that leadership word would have to be studied to really see what it's talking about. And then the last clause says, if it is showing mercy, let him do it cheerfully. Now, there would be a lot more to that, too. Showing mercy, what does that mean? You have to look that word up, and you'd be able to get more of a scope on that as far as a function in the body of Christ. Then it goes on with verse 9. Love must be sincere. It says love without hypocrisy in the King James. Now, these little sort of pithy phrases here, little short sentences and phrases coming up here in the next few verses are really loaded with great truth. I mean, each of these little sentences or phrases is certainly in itself a great goal for our lives. Love without hypocrisy. Boy, I'd like to do that all the time. Look what the next one says. Hate what is evil. Cleave, it says in the King James, or cling, or really like be welded to what is good. Hate what is evil. Now God's word throughout, and we'll see it even again in Romans 16, there is a
God hates evil. He hates it with a passion. And we, as children of God, are not supposed to be complacent about evil. We're supposed to hate it. And conversely, we're supposed to cleave to what is good. So together, those form a very healthy emotion, you might say. It's not just hating evil. I hate it. No, that has to be tempered with cleaving to that which is good. Otherwise, you become negative and bummed out and downtrodden, discouraged. We hate evil. Well, what do we do about it? We cleave to that which is good and we share it. Verse 10. Be devoted to one another in brotherly love. Now remember I said verses 3 to about 16 are regarding the Christian within the context of the one body. Honor one another above yourselves. Now see, this doesn't say that there's any kind of hierarchy or someone in the body of Christ is better than someone else. We know that's not true. Because Galatians, your old friend Galatians 3:28 says that in the body of Christ, there's neither Jew nor Gentile. There's no ethnic differentiation. It says there's neither bond nor free. There's no social differentiation. And it says there's neither male nor female. There's no sexual differentiation. It says in the last clause in that verse, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. There is no differentiation by any standard in the body of Christ that puts one over another, because Holy Spirit is the equalizing factor. Now, Holy Spirit is the equalizing factor, and Holy Spirit is what gives you the ability to serve. And here's the attitude. Honor one another above yourselves. You can see the same truth in Ephesians 5:21, where it says, to all Christians, submitting yourselves one to another in the reverence of Christ. And the word submitting is hupo tasso, to place under. Hupo means under, tasso means to place. We'll see that word tasso coming up in the next chapter. To place under. How do I, as a Christian, place myself under you? I serve you. I lay down my life for you as a servant. Just what we've seen in Romans. Not because there's any kind of ladder or chain of command or corporate hierarchy or anything in the body of Christ, but because Jesus Christ was our example of one who laid down his life in service. And this is in Romans 12 is the same thing. Honor one another above yourselves. Never, verse 11, never be lacking in zeal, but keep your spiritual fervor serving the Lord. It takes a little gumption, a little initiative, a little energy to be zealous. Again, that's why this is in the context of the one body. Man, oh man, I mean, how much of a blessing is it when someone says, thank you so much for sharing that with me. You have really blessed my life. Or thank you for praying for me. Isn't that kind of encouraging? Remember the mutual, we saw that Romans 1:12, that is, that I may be encouraged by you and by your faith like you would be by me. That's why we need one another in the body of Christ. Verse 12. Be joyful in hope. There's a great biblical relation or relationship between joy and hope. Hope is like the bottom line for joy. No matter what happens here, we will laugh last. And he who laughs, lasts. Okay? So, we are, it says, now look at these little exhortations here. Be joyful in hope, patient in affliction. The word patient means to hang in there. Affliction is like mental pressure. Faithful in prayer. See, each of these little things is a great goal in itself. Verse 13, here it says again, share with God's people who are in need. Practice hospitality. In the King James, it says pursue hospitality. And the word, now look at the next verse. First word is bless, right? Bless those who persecute you. I think you'll find that the word persecute is the same word as practice hospitality. To practice, to pursue, the King James translates it. It's the Greek word dioko, and it means to run after or to pursue. See, I said it takes gumption, energy, action. Practice hospitality, and that's kindness to others, kindness to strangers, you might say. And practice makes perfect. We've all heard that. So it says, it's interesting here because it says, pursue hospitality. Then it says, bless those who persecute you, bless and do not curse. And I really think that verse 14 is still primarily here in the context of the one body. Because in the one body, I mean, look at, you can just look around and see that Christians are not always being that nice to one another. And they're in the chapters coming up, chapters 14, especially chapter 14, we'll see some keys to avoiding division and wrangling in the body over insignificant matters. Because we're not all going to agree on everything. But we can agree on the basic doctrinal issues to the end that we knit our hearts together and function effectually. So, I think this is still, now sure, this principle would pertain to others, but it says bless those who persecute you, bless and do not curse. The word bless means to invoke God's blessing on. Now again, this is sort of where the rubber meets the road in Christianity. This is where you get out of the talking stage and into doing it. How easy is it to invoke God's blessing on someone who's persecuting you? That hasn't always been my immediate reaction. Well, the word persecute, the way I look at this, it says practice hospitality. Pursue hospitality. Then it says bless those who pursue you. Now, in my strange mind, I see a cartoon chase with perhaps Heckle and Jekyll or Bugs or one of the other great American heroes. And so they're chasing Bugs, and all of a sudden Bugs turns around and starts chasing Yosemite Sam. And that's the way I look at this. Of course, you don't have to look at it that way. Praise God. But pursue hospitality. Someone's persecuting. Someone's pursuing you, and you turn around and pursue him with kindness and love. Okay, we'll move on. Verse 15 talks about empathizing with others. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Don't you like to share your good news, or you got a promotion, or you got healed, or you got a prayer answered, or you got revelation, or you some great thing happening? Don't you want to tell people? And what if they just say, yeah, it's great? Don't you like them to get enthused about it? Once again, my mind is, I'm seeing Larry Bird bury a three-pointer at the buzzer to defeat the Lakers in the final game of the NBA playoff. Now, wouldn't I love to share that? And don't you like to share it with some other rabid Celtic fan as opposed to someone who's never heard of basketball? Well, we're getting into the twilight zone here. But you see, it says also mourn with those who mourn. This is the heart of empathizing. This takes time. It takes effort. It takes a real willingness to be a part of someone else's life and let him be a part of your life. And as I say, these are goals. I certainly don't have all these things mastered. Verse 16, see, live in harmony with one another. What we've just seen from verse 9, especially on, are keys to doing just that. Now, this is going to lead, Romans in one way leads into Ephesians. And you can see how Ephesians elaborates upon the doctrine of the one body, and then in chapters 4, 5, and 6, basically, of Ephesians, gives keys similar to these. Do not be proud, but be willing to associate with people of low position. I think that's talking about in the body of Christ that, again, there's neither bond nor free. There's no social distinction. It says, do not be conceited, the end of the verse here. It's very easy to succumb to the world's perverted value system that we talked about, where we think more highly of ourselves than others. But what we just read was, anybody with Holy Spirit, I don't care if he's a bum on the street or whatever, if he has Holy Spirit, he is a member in particular of the body of Christ with every spiritual blessing that you have. And that's the way we need to look at one another. Hey, Romans 1 through 8. Remember I said the more that we see one another in that light, the more we will treat one another accordingly, just like the Apostle Paul. Then, verse 17 says, do not repay anyone evil for evil. See, it's not this revengeful attitude that we have. That doesn't mean you get walked on all the time and you never stand up for your rights. That isn't repaying evil for evil. To stand up for your rights and say, look, get out of my face. You are off the word of God and I'm not going to put up with your evil. That doesn't. But it's not to react in kind. And I think there's a great key here again, and we'll see it coming up in greater detail, about our heart as a doulos for God. Because remember, it was the master who took care of the doulos. It was up to him to provide everything that the doulos needed to do the master's will. And so we, as douloses, belong to God. And that's why I don't have to be so paranoid, if you will, about everyone else ripping me off all the time or cheating me. That doesn't mean I don't walk with consciousness and alertness and spiritual wisdom, but my trust is in God, not in my own efforts. You know, the wrath of man works not the righteousness of God, that kind of thing. Verse 18. I didn't finish 17. Be careful to do what is right in the eyes of everybody. In other words, be a good Joe. Try to bless everybody. And now that's not always possible. That's why verse 18 says, if it is possible. See the essence of this? The heart is that you care about everybody. And no matter who they are, especially in the body of Christ, you try to show them God's love in practical ways. See, love is practical. My mom always used to tell me, courtesy is love in little things, like opening a door for someone. If it is possible, providing he wants to go through it. Verse 18, never mind. If it is possible, as far as it depends on you, live at peace with everyone. What a great verse. How many of us live too often in reaction or response to what other people do? Well, if my wife would only just stop doing that, then I'd be able to do that. Well, that's not the Christian attitude. The Christian attitude is, I orient my heart to God's word, and from that basis, reach out to every person accordingly, no matter what they do. Verse 19. Do not take revenge, my friends, but leave room for God's wrath, for it is written, it is mine to avenge, I will repay, says the Lord. On the contrary, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he is thirsty, give him something to drink. In doing this, you will heap burning coals on his head. And I've heard this verse explained according to an Eastern custom, and I believe it's right, till I hear something that makes more sense, because some people might read this and say, yeah, you're going to heap burning coals on his head, because one day when he's burning in the flames of hell, he's going to burn more because you were nice to him when he was being mean to you. Something like that. Well, who wants anyone to burn forever in the flames of hell?
And by the way, the Bible doesn't say that that's going to happen to anyone except the devil, as far as I can read it, when you read exactly what's written. So that's another subject that you can study. Yeah, people are going to get thrown in a lake of fire. What happens when you throw someone in a lake of fire? You get burned up. And that's what's going to happen according to God's word. But you see this heap burning coals on his head? Look, the whole context is blessing someone. Look at the next verse, 21. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. So, in the East, when, of course, they had no furnaces in their homes and they often heated by a fire, they would have in the middle of the little village a central fire that certain people kept going all the time, so that in the morning, when the people in their homes nearby would wake up, they would send a representative from their family with a piece of pottery or something like that to pick up some coals to bring home and start their own fire. And they would often put the little, you know how you see people walking with a pot on their head? I don't think I could do that right now. I'd have to practice a lot. But anyway, you see these ladies with a water pot or other things. And they'd carry the hot coals in that pottery. And on a cold morning, it would be a source of warmth and blessing to them as they made their way back to their home. And that is the point of this phrase, heat burning coals on their head. So, if you have a better explanation, let me know. But that fits with the context. You will bless the person. If your enemy's hungry, feed him. If he's thirsty, give him something to drink. These are Christian acts. In doing this, you'll make him fry forever. No, you'll bless him. You'll provide a source of warmth and blessing, so to speak, to him. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. Now, the end, where you see this transition, I think there's a transition in chapter 12, along about 16, 17, 18 in there, where he begins to shift to the Christian looking out to the world, so to speak. In other words, how now do we live in regard to society, to all people? And that includes civil authority. And after we flip the tape in a moment, we're going to begin in chapter 13. Because chapter 13 regards the Christian's attitude toward civil authority. And this is a great truth that we're going to elaborate upon to some degree, because God is the one who set up the idea of civil authority. And the reason he did it was so that there would be social order. And the reason he wanted social order is so that we can do the verses that we just read, so that we can live a quiet and peaceable life in all godliness and sincerity, the King James says in 1 Timothy 2:2, I believe it is, or 2:1. And so, you see, if it be possible, as far as depends on you, live at peace with everyone. If there were no civil authority, it would be very difficult to do that, because you'd be shooting people on your lawn when they're trying to storm your house to take what you own. Even with civil authority, people sometimes try to do that. Before we actually begin reading with Romans 13:1, I'd like you to put your marker here and turn to 1 Timothy chapter 2, a verse that I mentioned. And I want to show you three short sections before we come back to Romans. And this will lay the groundwork, set the foundation for understanding Romans 13:1 and following. Now, most Bibles make it pretty plain that Romans 13:1 is talking about civil authority. There have been people over the years who have twisted Romans 13:1 and said that it means spiritual authority. So everyone has to submit himself to the reverend, the clergyman, you know, the new superhero. And then they take the verses 1 to 7 in that light. When we read them, especially in light of what I'm going to share with you now, we will see that that is a travesty and simply another ploy by people to keep other people under their thumb. Chapter 13, 1 to 7 has absolutely nothing to do with spiritual authorities. It's like everyone must submit himself to the governing authorities, meaning the church authorities. Well, first of all, here's a good question. If that's true, who are they? Who are they? Well, so you have a meeting to decide this, and you have the head of every denomination in the meeting. So you ask the question. Now, gentlemen, we're here to resolve the question, who are the, what the King James calls, higher powers? So, Dr. So-and-so or Reverend so-and-so, and now, obviously, they're all going to think it is they. You see, the point is, we would never be able to resolve who is it talking about? Who? What group? What people? What gives them that authority? But let's say we are discussing this issue, and a masked man comes in and robs all of us. Is there any argument about who to call? No. Call the police. You know, the representative of civil authority. He is very recognizable. And these are some of the great truths that we will see. Now remember, again, I said that God, it was God's idea to set up civil authority, not regarding a person. Like people say, well, Hitler, what about Hitler? Well, Hitler was evil. God did not intend for someone to rule like that, but the position or the idea of a civil ruler was God's idea. Why? The basic bottom line answer is that God knew that the natural man, the man of body and soul, the carnal mind, enmity against God, he knew that the natural man would not fear him and would not obey him, and would just run wild and steal and pillage and everything else. But he knew that the natural man would fear other men's laws and the corresponding punishment that would be meted out when those laws were broken. It is a very biblical truth that the fear of punishment dissuades evil. And that is absolutely true. The fear of punishment dissuades evil. And God also knew that a lot of religious fanatics that would come along over the years would kill thousands of people. And we are going to see a record where it was the civil authority that saved the life of the apostle Paul. And that because religious fanatics were going to kill him. And so, once again, God set up civil authority so that there would be social order. See, social order doesn't just happen. There must be laws to govern behavior and punishment for breaking those laws to put teeth into them. And it's sad to see what's happened in America to the judicial system, because it's so far from the biblical truth that it is resulting in more and more crime and less punishment. So, God's Word makes it plain that fear of consequences dissuades people from evil. Temporal authorities exist for peace. And we will see why this was God's idea. What God intended, of course, was that they be fair, honest, just men. And it's not unavailable for Christians to enter what you would call perhaps the political arena. That would ensure
If you ran for mayor and got elected, I'm not going to do this. But if you have that on your heart, it's not wrong. See, and I'd vote for you. And if you ran for mayor, then I'd know that the mayor was an honest Christian man who would make decisions in light of God's word. And I'd be blessed with that. Well, let's read 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 1. I urge then, first of all, that requests, prayers, intercession, and thanksgiving be made for everyone, for kings and all those in authority. That, why? Why do we pray for civil authority? Because the welfare of believers is greatly affected by civil authority. The decisions that they make would greatly affect our welfare. And secondly, the welfare of unbelievers is enhanced when believers are free to speak the word. That makes sense, right? So we pray for kings and all those in authority, that we may live peaceful and quiet lives in all godliness and holiness. Now watch the context of this as you read on here. This is good and pleases God our Savior, who wants all men to be saved and to come to a knowledge of the truth. See just what I said. Look at the context of this praying for the kings and the governor and the president and the senator and this kind of thing. Because God wants all men to be saved and come to a knowledge of the truth. And when there is social order and freedom and peace, then it is, in a lot of ways, much easier to reach out with God's word without fear of persecution or all kinds of hassle. See? Look at Titus, Timothy, Titus chapter 3. Titus chapter 3. Oh, this is great, great stuff here. Titus 3. Now watch. It makes so much sense. Because when we get back to Romans 13, I'll show you a lot of verses that there's no way they make sense if it's regarding the church. See? We'll see that. Because we already saw in chapter 12, verse 5, that everyone is members one of another. If we're members one of another, then how can I be a higher power over you? There's no such thing in the body of Christ. All right, chapter 3 of Titus, verses 1 and 2. Remind the people to be subject to rulers and authorities. Hupotasso is that same word, subject, to place under. That means I, by my freedom of will, subject myself to the laws of the land as long as they do not usurp my spiritual rights. If they pass a law in my state that says it is illegal to own a Bible, well, I'm going to break that law. Now, I'm not going to necessarily tell you what to do, and you have to break it. You'll have to make up your own mind. But from my heart, I will not keep that law. The reason that I keep the laws of the land is because I try to, according to a higher law. And we'll see that in Romans. The reason that you do not steal is not because the law of your state says don't steal. If your state passed a law tomorrow that said stealing legalized, would you steal? No, because the Bible says don't steal. So you see, from the heart we obey, and from the heart we would disobey a law that prohibited us from doing God's will. Remind the people to be subject to rulers and authorities, to be obedient, to be ready to do whatever is good, to slander no one, to be peaceable and considerate, and to show true humility toward all men. What a great truth. In other words, just to be mellow, you might say, and a friendly person, this kind of thing. You know what this is talking about. Look at 1 Peter chapter 2. This is the Christian attitude, because this is a good witness. And again, our security is in the Lord, because we're doulos to Him. 1 Peter 2, 13. The NIV does not have the verses right down the left side column. That makes it harder to find them sometimes. 1 Peter 2:13. Submit yourselves for the Lord's sake. See? For the sake of living for the Lord and helping people see God's love and so forth. Don't be a rabble-rouser. Submit yourselves for the Lord's sake to every authority instituted among men. Now, if you were looking at these verses in the King James Version, you would be seeing in all the verses that we just read, in 1 Timothy 2, Titus 3, and 1 Peter 2, 13 to 17 that we're going to read here, you would be seeing the same words that we will read in Romans 13. The word higher, the word powers, the word subject, let every soul be subject to the higher powers is Romans 13:1 in the King James. And you would be seeing the same verse, the same words. And that's one reason why we are reading these particular verses. Higher is one of these, is the word supreme here, as to the supreme authority. So the point is, when you look at the words in Romans 13:1 in some of their other uses, you see, hey, this isn't talking about the church, for heaven's sake. And we'll see that when we get back to Romans 13. Submit yourselves, for the Lord's sake, to every authority instituted among men, whether to the king as the supreme authority, or to governors who are sent by him, the king, to punish those who do wrong, and to commend those who do right. We'll see that principle in Romans 13, verse 15. For it is God's will that by doing good you should silence the ignorant talk of foolish men. Live as free men. See, now we're free in Christ, and we're going to see this so greatly when we get into Romans 14, and I'll read you out of 1 Corinthians 6 and 8 and 10 about all things are lawful, but all things are not expedient. So you know why all things are lawful to the Christian? Because we're not under any law. There's no law that says, don't do this, so to speak. We are free, but we don't use our freedom as a cover-up for evil. You could say, I'm free in Christ. I don't have to obey those civil laws. I'm going to drive 110 miles an hour. I think the speed limit's too low. I'm out there moving the word. Well, that's not really the attitude that God is looking for. And look at the last clause of verse 16. Live as servants of God is the word doulos. We belong to God. Show proper respect to everyone. Love the brotherhood of believers. Fear God, honor the king. Now, let's go back to Romans 13 and begin reading in verse 1. And in the very first word in the NIV, everyone, the King James reads, let every soul. We've got a problem if this is talking about the church. Because it says in the King James, let every soul. Well, the answer for by those who say that Romans 13 is talking about church authorities, like Reverend so-and-so, is, well, every soul means every Christian because this is Romans written to the church. Well, sorry, look it up. Look up the way the word soul is used. That's not how it's used. It's used regarding, remember, 278 souls on the boat in Acts 27. Some were Christians, some were not Christians. And verse, how could everyone submit to the authorities of the church? Everyone in the world. Stop the tape and go drag your neighbors over, because after all, this is a higher power speaking here and they ought to be subject. No, see, that's nonsense. Verse 1. Everyone must submit himself to the governing authorities, for there is no authority except that which God has established. The authorities that exist have been established by God. Yes, God was really in favor of Adolf Hitler and set him up. God personally put Hitler in there and applauded his acts. That's not what we're talking about. Remember what I've just shared in the other verses that we read? It's talking about the idea of civil authority being God's. And you can see this in the Old Testament, Deuteronomy and so forth, as God established civil law for his people along with the ceremonial aspects of the Mosaic law. verse 2. Consequently, he who rebels against the authority is rebelling against what God has instituted. And those who do so will bring judgment on themselves. The word judgment means judicial sentence. And that's what civil authorities are empowered to mete out. Judicial sentence. That's not what a minister does to people. Minister meaning a servant, not someone elevated above everyone else. Matter of fact, he's supposed to be down there with the people. But in any case, they'll bring judgment on themselves. See, these words are all regarding civil authority. Here comes one, verse 3. For rulers, for rulers. Now, someone might say that this rulers goes back to chapter 12, verse 8, where in the King James it uses the word rule. See, if it is leadership, let him govern diligently, let him rule. Unfortunately, it's a completely different Greek word, and the Greek word in Romans 13:3 for rulers, in its 37 uses, never regards believers. It's used regarding civil authority, religious authority like the Pharisees, Beelzebub, and devil spirits. So, civil authority is what it's talking about, nothing to do with the church. For rulers, like the police as a representative of the king, so to speak, for rulers hold no terror for those who do right. When you're driving 55 in a 55, are you worried, that is, afraid, of dealing with civil authority, of them getting on you? No! You just cruise along, chatting, listening to music. But when you're going 85, your attitude is a lot different. Your eyes are darting from one mirror to the other, to the radar detector. You're not chatting with anyone. Your knuckles are white, gripping the wheel maybe. Okay, an extreme example, but we see the point. But rulers do hold terror for those who do wrong, the verse goes on. You see, fear of consequences dissuades evil. What would the world be like if there were no civil authority? It'd be absolute chaos. I mean, it's almost that now. What would happen if people said, stealing legalized? You wouldn't probably be listening to this tape. You'd be at the window of your home with a shotgun, keeping people out of your house. Do you see this? Do you want to be free from fear of the one in authority? Then do what is right, and he will commend you. Now, in the NIV Study Bible notes on verses 3 and then verse 4, I'll read you that too, it says, Paul is not stating that this will always be true, but is describing the proper ideal function of rulers. See, God's not responsible for people like Hitler coming along, or Noriega, or Stalin, or some of these Mao Zedong, these people that have killed millions and millions of people. Well, collectively, when civil rulers, it goes on, overstep their proper function, the Christian is to obey God rather than man. Remember that in the book of Acts? And then it says in verse 4, for he is God's servant to do you good. And the note says, in the order of divine providence, the ruler is God's servant. Rulers exist for the benefit of society, to protect the general public by maintaining good order. Verse 4, he is God's servant to do you good. But if you do wrong, be afraid, for he does not bear the sword for nothing. The note reads, "The symbol of Roman authority, the sword, is the symbol of Roman authority on both the national and international levels. Here we find the biblical principle of using force for the maintenance of good order." Of course, that principle has been perverted and twisted, but that doesn't mean it's not true. Peace through strength is a biblical principle, and one that we in this country would do well to take more heed to. Now, the word sword. Oh, there's a real churchy word. No, for heaven's sake. In Vincent's New Testament word studies on this word, he says the sword is, quote, "born as a symbol of the magistrate's right to inflict capital punishment," unquote. God never uses such a figure regarding the church and the authority. He always talks about the shepherd's staff, a servant, this kind of thing, not a ruler and a sword and all that. That is what religious hierarchies have done to subject people to their own evil desires. Verse 4 continues, "He," this representative of the civil authority, "he is God's servant." This is the word diakonos, sometimes translated minister, servant. It's used regarding believers. It's used regarding regular servants. And once, it's used regarding devil spirits. So it doesn't automatically mean that this is the Christian church. And obviously, it's not talking about that. Therefore, it is necessary to submit to the authorities. Now, in verse 4, it says, "an agent of wrath to bring punishment on the wrongdoer." This is where, keep your marker here and go to Acts 21:27. Here is a great record. I just think this is so wonderful. Acts 21:27. Here's where Paul gets his life saved. See, a minister, King James uses the word, he brings terror on you and so forth. That's not what a minister is supposed to do, a servant in the body of Christ. Acts 21:27. "When the 7 days were nearly over," I'm reading you this as a pertinent and vivid biblical example of the truth that we are seeing in Romans 13 regarding the function of civil authority when they do what they're supposed to do. "When the 7 days were nearly over, some Jews from the province of Asia spotted Paul at the temple." There he is. "They stirred up the whole crowd and seized him, shouting, 'Men of Israel, help us. This is the man who teaches all men everywhere against our people and our law and this place," oh, the holy temple. "And beside that, he's brought Gentiles, Greeks, into the temple area and defiled the holy place." (Parenthesis, they had previously seen Trophimus the Ephesian in the city with Paul, and assumed that Paul had brought him into the temple area. Do people ever do that? Do they ever assume things? Can there be big hassles and things blown way out of proportion because people misunderstand or assume, or because one little lie gets magnified? And supposedly civil authority can sort out that kind of problem. Well, verse 30. Now, sometimes they contribute to it. And I know, obviously, we look around. We don't have to be too astute to recognize that today, and probably in whatever country you live in, I live in America, and obviously we see it in the newspaper all the time. The Ethics Committee is now investigating Senator so-and-so, policeman so-and-so took a bribe, Congressman so-and-so is on the take. It's gross. I know that. It's ridiculous. The situation is insane. But that doesn't mean that the idea was wrong. And you perhaps have experientially seen how it can work properly for the benefit of people. And the people, of course, remember that God had in mind that it would really benefit our Christians so that we can live a quiet and peaceable life in all godliness and sincerity and reach out with his word to all men that he wants to be saved. Now, they're not all going to believe. We know that.
But, verse 30. The whole city freaked out. The whole city was aroused. And the people came running from all directions. Now picture this, okay? Put your mind in this. Watch. Seizing Paul. Now how'd you like to be Paul? I imagine his heartbeat increased a little bit. You know, all these people running at him and they grabbed him. I wouldn't want to be in this situation. My gosh, a big mob. They dragged him from the temple and immediately the gates were shut. They shut the door behind them. Verse 31. While they were trying to what? Kill him. Somebody called the cops. News reached the commander of the Roman troops that the whole city of Jerusalem was in an uproar. You know, Barney Fife sitting there, ring the phone, got a disturbance over here at 4th and Elm, a big mob, looks like a big fight, better get over here. Someone recognized the need for civil authority to do its job. So Andy and Barney roared away to the scene. Verse 32. Now watch, literally. He at once took some officers and soldiers, and what's the next word? Strolled? Lollygagged? No. Ever heard that noise? It indicates civil authority on the move at high speed to solve a problem. Well, I don't know if that's the noise they made when they ran so that the crowd would separate, but they ran down. Now, picture this. You see, here is civil authority doing its job. Now, watch. Suppose there had been no civil authority, Paul might have been killed. When the rioters saw the police, the commander and his soldiers, they kept beating Paul, and then they beat the commander and his soldiers, and they went and beat Caesar. No. Fear of consequences from civil authority dissuades evil. That's exactly what we see here. When the rioters saw the commander and his soldiers, they quit beating Paul. Well, now watch. This is not all. The commander came up and arrested him and ordered him to be bound with two chains. He was obviously a focal person in the furor. But then, what does he do? He starts asking questions. Get the facts, man. I just want to get the facts. Then he asked who he was and what he had done. Well, the crowd started screaming. Some in the crowd shouted one thing and some another. And since the commander could not get at the truth because of the uproar, he took Paul into protective custody. He ordered that Paul be taken into the barracks. See? This man was doing his job properly. And Paul was very grateful. When Paul reached the steps, the violence of the mob was so great, he had to be carried by the soldiers. Picture yourself in Paul's position here, being carried by soldiers away from a mob. I bet he was pretty thankful. The crowd that followed kept shouting, "Away with him!" As the soldiers were about to take Paul into the barracks, he asked the commander, "May I say something to you?" Now, this man was a good man, apparently. He did his job anyway. "Do you speak Greek?" he replied, because Paul spoke to him in Greek. "Aren't you the Egyptian who started a revolt and led 4,000 terrorists out into the desert some time ago?" Now, this man may have thought that, but at least here he gives Paul the opportunity to speak for himself. Paul answered, "I am a Jew from Tarsus in Cilicia, a citizen of no ordinary city. Please let me speak to the people." And the guy saw that he was a Roman citizen. Verse 40. Having received the commander's permission, Paul stood on the steps and motioned to the crowd. And then he began to speak and he got to share with them. So, back to Romans 13. What a great record that is, isn't it? Civil authority doing its job exactly like it's supposed to. Now here comes verse 5. "Therefore, it is necessary to submit to the authorities, not only because of possible punishment, but also because of conscience." And that ties in with what I said, that we either obey or disobey from the heart. The point of what this is saying in verse 5 is that you don't obey civil law
just so you don't get in trouble. You obey the right civil laws because it's the right thing to do in God's sight. Your conscience, the word that you as a Christian have built in your heart. Now, there are some people in your city right now who are refraining from stealing because they're afraid of getting caught and going to jail. Of course, the justice system is so bogged down that they would perhaps never end up in jail, probably be out on the street in a matter of hours, and eventually, if they did get arrested, they could plea bargain and have a few months in jail, and you would perhaps still be out what they stole from you and never get it back, and then your taxes pay more for them to sit in jail, and you end up losing twice. Well, that wasn't God's idea. There are some countries in the world where the penalty for stealing is to have your hand chopped off immediately when you are found guilty. And the trial is not held 1 year after the crime is committed. Now, having a hand chopped off for stealing sort of makes people think twice about stealing. Wouldn't you say? Sure. And so that's verse 5. Then it says, verse 6, now here, these two verses, 6 and 7, is where those who twist Romans 13, 1 and following to say that it means church authorities, here is where they get the money. Here is where these are verses used as leverage for the Christian to send in his 10% or whatever they say he should send to them. Now, we've already seen, and we'll see it again, it is biblical to help those who teach God's word if they bless you. That, you know that. But it has to come from a heart that desires to do that, not from some imposed so-called law. But if you look these verses up, the key verses here, custom and so forth, you'll see that the NIV translates them accurately as taxes, verse 6. This is also why you pay taxes. For the authorities are God's servants who give their full time to governing. So they don't have a product that they sell to earn income. They provide a service, and those to whom they provide the service are the ones who should support them. That goes right along with the biblical principle of muzzle not the ox who treads out the corn. Let him eat a little of it so he can keep doing his job. Now, I would be perfectly willing to pay taxes. Well, I'm willing to do it now. I pay taxes now. Of course, I think that the tax system is inequitable. I am sad to see that much of the money that I pay in taxes is used for things that I think are contrary to God's word. And I'm proud to say that as an American, I have the right to express that verbally. That doesn't mean that I become a rabble-rouser and refuse to pay my taxes, because then I'm going to spend my whole life in court, and I might end up doing jail outreach, and that's not what I want. So what God is saying here, again, is the attitude of, look, I take care of you. Just go along with the program until you feel it stops you from doing God's will. But it says just go along with the program. And we'd all be very willing, of course, to pay our fair share of taxes. Perhaps there would be one percentage that everyone would pay. And that would certainly be incentive for people, because then they wouldn't have so much taken away from them to give to people who refuse to work, or others who or other programs that the government may have that you don't agree with. But certainly, we would be very willing to support the mayor, the police chief, the road commissioner, the utility people, these kinds of things. I'm thankful for those services. I don't want to do those things. And I'd be perfectly happy to pay taxes for those things to be done. And I do. And this is what this is talking about. Verse 7. Give everyone what You owe him. Again, you can look up these words and see their definitions. Give everyone what you owe him. If you owe taxes, pay taxes. If revenue, then revenue. If respect, then respect. If honor, then honor. Now, there have been certain presidents, for example, I live in America, there have been certain presidents that I thought were far below par, let me put it mildly, but I would have given them respect had I met them because of the office that they hold. That doesn't mean I wouldn't exercise my right to peaceably disagree with their policies, but I respect the office, therefore I would have shown respect to them. And I think that's what this is talking about, respect and honor. Let me read a couple paragraphs to wrap up this little subject of the Christian and civil authority from Just and the Justifier by Mr. Welch. Regarding these verses, and his quotes are from the King James, but it says, "We must needs be subject," quote, unquote, says the apostle, quote, "not only for wrath, but also for conscience sake," unquote. That was verse 5. "Many are obedient out of fear, who would rebel if the cause of fear were to be removed. There are many who are respectable citizens, not because of positive and formative volition, but because the negative and enslaving power of fear. The Christian must always act, quote, for conscience sake, unquote, whether he obeys the voice of authority or decides that it is right to disobey it. Neither fear of consequences nor hope of reward must enter into the secret counsels of the heart. The Christian should be able to, quote, talk with crowds, unquote, and yet keep his virtue and, quote, walk with kings, unquote." I'm not sure where those quotes are from. It's a poem or a novel or some kind of a thing of this, both ends of the spectrum. To be able to talk with crowds, in other words, mingle with what you would call common people, and then walk with kings. The Christian, on the other hand, should be able to talk with crowds and yet keep his virtue and walk with kings without losing the common touch. And this is exactly what the principles in Romans 12 led into. Remember, the King James says, "condescend to men of low estate." It's just this wonderful conciliatory attitude in the heart of one who knows that he belongs to God forever. And Welch goes on, "We must also remember that because we own no man as Lord," in other words, no man is our Lord, no higher power, "and all our service is rendered in the name of the Lord Jesus, this does not mean that we may demonstrate our liberty by being discourteous or uncouth." See, as free, but not using our liberty for a cloak of maliciousness, the King James read in 1 Peter 3:16. "If we are to follow the teaching of Scripture, we must," quote, "render to all their dues," unquote. And he goes on, "Each generation brings with it its own peculiar problems. These are not solved for us in a ready-made fashion in Romans 13. The principles, however, are given." The principles are given. "And these must be applied in the light of the truth as the occasion demands. Above all, we must keep prominently in mind that spirit of Christian charity which pervades this section of Scripture like incense. And we must keep in mind that spirit of conciliation which is but the reflection to external enemies of the grace that has brought us nigh." One more time on that last sentence. "Above all, we must keep prominently in mind that spirit of Christian charity which pervades this section like incense, and that spirit of conciliation which is but the reflection to external enemies of the grace that has brought us near. What a great statement. And so let's wrap up chapter 13 here before this tape ends, verse 8. Let no debt remain outstanding except the continuing debt of love. The continuing debt of love, to love one another, because that debt you never fully pay. We're always supposed to love. For he who loves his fellow man has fulfilled the law. Verse 9, here are some examples of the law. The commandments, for example, do not commit adultery, do not murder, do not steal, do not covet, and whatever other commandment there may be, are summed up in this one rule. Love your neighbor as yourself. Love does no harm to its neighbor. We read this same principle in Galatians 5, 13 and 14, remember? Love does no harm to its neighbor. Therefore, love is the fulfillment of the law. See how that ties with what we just read? Verse 11, and do this, understanding the present time. He's talking about what is the Christian's attitude toward the world. And the point he's going to make is that we should realize how bad the world is, so to speak. In other words, how godless the God of this age and all that he promotes, how bad the situation is from God's Word. We realize from the Word that we are should be motivated to exert a diligent effort to do God's will. We are the lights of the world, the Bible says. It goes on, the hour has come for you to wake up from your slumber, because our salvation is nearer now than when we first believed. That makes sense. In other words, it's a day closer today than it was yesterday to the appearing of Christ. The sands of time, you might say, are running out. Let's make hay while the sun shines. This is cliche city here. Verse 12. The night is nearly over. What night? The darkness of this world, the God of this age, his dominion and authority over things. The night is nearly over. That doesn't mean that it's going to be next week or next year. We don't know that. That's not the point of these kinds of uses. I'll show you again another one in Romans 16 and explain it in greater detail there. The day is almost here. It's the perspective of hope. So let us put aside the deeds of darkness and put on, same thing, what we've seen in Romans, to put on the armor of light. Verse 13, let us behave decently as in the daytime. People act a lot differently sometimes during the day than under the cover of darkness or under the covers of darkness. Okay. Not in orgies and drunkenness, not in sexual immorality and debauchery, not in dissension and jealousy. Rather, verse 14, clothe yourselves with the Lord Jesus Christ and do not think about how to gratify the desires of the sinful nature. In other words, make your priority in life that of serving the Lord Jesus Christ, first in the body of Christ and then in the world as you bless all men. Well, here we go, starting our final tape, and we're ready for Romans 14, verse 1. Let's read this verse, and then we'll talk about it. Accept him whose faith is weak, without passing judgment on disputable matters. I will point out to you later, and it's in the next chapter, that I think accept is a very weak translation of this particular word. Accepting, it gives you like, yeah, well, I'll accept him. I can accept that. You know, that kind of thing. It's much more active. That's rather passive. This is much more active, and it means to reach out and take unto yourself, that kind of thing. But anyway, accept him whose faith is weak without passing judgment on disputable matters. Now, we need to keep our marker here because we need to talk about this in setting the context of this chapter. First of all, it's going to be some practical keys to maintaining unity in the one body and not having a lot of division unnecessarily. We're going to see that these are matters of conscience. What follows will be matters of conscience rather than black and white scriptural issues. God never, and we'll see that in Romans 16, never exhorts us to compromise on doctrinal purity. But there are a lot of things like the examples that God chooses here, which are not doctrinal matters, but rather personal preference for whatever reason. Now God's going to choose the example of meat and eating. First of all, the Jew was very oriented from the Old Testament to such dietary rules and regulations. And of course, all those things were set for the benefit of the people, and I don't think we could go wrong to generally gear our lives by some of those things, because obviously God was trying to help those people be healthy. I think also involved in here is just what a big deal food is to everyone. I love to eat. I doubt if you just eat for the heck of it. We all love to eat. Okay. Well, so today there are certain similar dietary squabbles that could divide Christians. There are also other issues like whether or not you should wear makeup or go dancing or have long hair or short hair. There are many, many things like this that you could put in this category. And God is going to set forth the proper attitude toward them. The King James in verse 1 says, "Receive him not to doubtful disputations." This says here, without passing judgment on disputable matters. Now, it's not the faculty of perception that is being warned against here. It is not we are supposed to judge according to the Word of God. But we'll see that these are not doctrinal black and white issues, but rather personal preference, things of personal preference. So it's not the faculty of perception being warned against here, but rather unkind, legalistic, or those with freedom criticizing a less mature believer. And in the context of the Jew and Gentile, the Jews who had been accustomed to the law might be tempted to criticize the Gentiles for their freedom, so to speak, and the Gentiles might tend to criticize the Jew for their, quote, legalism, or their still adherence to certain of these dietary aspects of the law. Look at Philippians chapter 4 to just see the heart of what God is trying to communicate here. Philippians 4 and we'll start with verse 4. I wanted to read verse 5. We'll get a running start in verse 4. It ties in, of course. Got it? Philippians 4:4. "Rejoice in the Lord always." Now, if you're doing that, you're probably in pretty good shape and not too concerned about a lot of little things going on in other people's lives and so forth. I will say it again. Rejoice. "Let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near." The word gentleness is the Greek word epikes. Epi, meaning upon, and the other part of the word, ekes, means fitting. Fitting upon. In other words, a square peg in a square hole. The right thing at the right time. This is the attitude here, this word for gentleness, the appropriate attitude in the situation. Look at James 3. Here's another verse that gives us an idea of how to understand what we're trying to get at here. James chapter 3 and Hebrews, James. It's talking about in verse 15, the wisdom that doesn't come from heaven is earthly, it's unspiritual, it's of the devil. Verse 17, but the wisdom that comes from heaven is first of all pure, then peace-loving, considerate, submissive, full of mercy and good fruit, impartial, and sincere. Peacemakers who sow in peace raise a harvest of righteousness. See verse 17? Just like Philippians 4:5, let your gentleness be known to all. Some have called this attitude or described it as charitable on insignificant points. And I think that is apt. Charitable on insignificant points. We are trying to live like God, with an attitude like God has, which is to look on the heart. You can be flipping to Galatians 4. There is a record that you may know about and may be very familiar with in 2 Kings chapter 5 about Naaman the leper, who was a great second in command of the whole army of Syria, and he came to Elijah to see if he could get healed. And anyway, Elijah does heal him, and he's about to leave, and he says, Naaman says to him, there's one more thing. I've got this job. I'm second in command of the entire army, and that means I'm under the king's authority. And he likes to worship. He goes to church over there at the first church of the Rimmonites. He worships Rimmon, the pagan god, and when he goes in, you know, it's my duty to go along there with him and be at his right hand there, and I have to bow when he bows, and, you know, would you mind? I mean, do you think that would be okay if I do that, because I really like to keep the job? And Elijah said, no! That's not what Elijah said. He said, go in pieces. No, that's not what he said either. He said, go in peace. Why? Because he saw that his heart was right, and he wouldn't be bowing in his heart. And so, this is the kind of attitude that I think this is talking about, that this section in Romans 14 is pleading for. You might call it also meeting aggression with aggression. Meeting aggression with aggression. Where you don't fly off the handle when the person's heart is not right and it's just sort of maybe a stupid comment or this kind of thing. But where it's real evil, then you stand up with the appropriate degree of sternness or whatever is necessary. Now, before we get going in Romans 14, there's an interesting point to be made, I think, and so we'll make it. In Galatians 4, 8, we'll read 8 to 11. Now, Romans is doctrine, that is, telling them the way it is. Galatians, we'll see in these verses, it's a little more harsh. You could use that word, harsh, due to it being the correction of doctrinal error. They had been told, and they had decided, we weren't going to do this, and they were even teaching error. So you can see his tone is just a little different here. It says, verse 8, formerly, when you did not know God, you were slaves to those who by nature are not gods. But now that you know God, or rather are known by God, how is it that you are turning back to those weak and miserable principles? Do you wish to be enslaved by them all over again? You are observing special days and months and seasons and years. I fear for you. Somehow I've wasted my efforts on you. See, it's just a little more stern. Well, let's go back to Romans 14 and start reading here. Verse 2. One man's faith, now we're talking of Christians, of course. One man's faith allows him to eat everything. Holy smoke. I'm not inviting that guy to my house. Oh, that was my favorite chair. Okay. But another man whose faith is weak eats only vegetables. In other words, he thinks that he should eat only vegetables for a spiritual reason. You understand? He's attributing some spiritual thing to that. Well, okay, so why get in a big argument about it? Let him eat his vegetables. We don't have to hassle about it. Maybe someday the opportunity would open if we could share something that would help him. But verse 3, the man who eats everything must not look down on him who does not. I don't know what goes through your mind. Sure, it's a little weird maybe. The man who eats everything must not look down on him who does not. He couldn't look down on him. He ate the ladder. Never mind. And the man now looked down on. The King James reads to despise. And it basically means to snub to the end of not treating the person properly. And this is not what we want in the body of Christ. See, we do not allow these little attitudes and so forth to affect the way in which we deal with one another. Isn't this great? Verse 3, the man who eats everything must not look down on him who does not, and the man who does not eat everything must not judge. Condemn is the word judge is krino, means to make a decision about. Who are must not judge the man who does, for God has accepted him. Who are you to judge someone else's servant? To his own master, and we know the master is the Lord Jesus Christ, he stands or falls, and he will stand, for the Lord is able to make him stand. The word krino, again, judge, means to make a decision about. Our decisions must be in light of the Word. See, this whole rap where, you know, some Christian does something that's just totally off the Word, and then you come along and say, hey, excuse me, you shouldn't have done that. And then they'll say, hey, who are you to judge me? That is completely off the wall and not at all what this section is talking about. We are to judge everything according to the perspective of the Scripture and to share in love with our brothers and sisters if we see them violating that standard. And why do we do it? For their benefit, not because we want to look better than they. See, you've got to have the right motive to do that. So the point of this is that we cannot impose. You see, we judge in light of the Word. Well, what the Word is saying here is that these things don't make any difference. So we don't impose our personal standards upon someone else. Because if we do, we usurp the lordship of his master. And we're going to see in the ensuing verses the lordship of Jesus Christ. Now, why do hierarchical organizations in Christianity facilitate the imposition of one's personal standards upon another? Because people get elevated. And then, oh, the great so-and-so, oh, the great so-and-so. Okay, so maybe the great so-and-so teaches some great things from the Bible, and so you think, oh, wow, thank you, wow, tell me, what else do you know? And that's wonderful. But then suppose the great so-and-so has this personal opinion about rutabaga. Anyone that eats rutabaga couldn't be spiritual. I hate rutabaga. So then we all start into the anti-rutabaga cult mentality. You see, but when we all are equal in the body of Christ, and there's only one Lord, the Lord Jesus Christ, then we are not so susceptible to allowing these personal preferences of others, quote, quote, above us, to be foisted onto us. Verse 5. One man considers one day more sacred than another. Another man considers every day alike. Each one should be fully convinced in his own mind. He who regards one day as special does so to the whom? the Lord. This is the lordship of Jesus Christ, as opposed to the lordship of factions, personalities, and other people. He who regards one day as special does so to the Lord. He who eats meat eats to the Lord. In other words, his heart is to do his best for the Lord. But these are the comparatively insignificant preferences in his own life. And he gives thanks to God. And he who abstains, the guy that just eats vegetables, he does so to the Lord, and he gives thanks to God. So both their hearts are right. For none of us, in other words, neither in this category, lives to himself alone, and none of us dies to himself alone. If we live, we live to the Lord, and if we die, we die to the Lord. The point is, the things that, in these categories, context, the things that this man may do, that I don't do, or that I do, that he may not do, I'm doing to the Lord, and he's the one that's going to judge us. So whether we live or die, we belong to the Lord. See? For this very reason, Christ died and returned to life, so he might be the Lord of both the dead and the living. The point is, and you'll see it very plainly in the next verse, let your Christian brethren do their own thing for Christ, as long as it doesn't contradict the Scriptures. And then let Christ do the judging when we all go to the Bema, verse 10. You then, why do you judge your brother, or why do you look down on your brother for these kinds of things? For we're all going to stand before God's judgment seat. It is written, as surely as I live, says the Lord, every knee will bow before me, every tongue will confess to God. And this verse 14:10 ties with 2 Corinthians 5:10 that we read, where it says the judgment seat of Christ, to receive that which we've done, whether it was good, and we get a reward, or worthless, we don't get a reward. There's no contradiction here, the judgment seat of God or judgment seat of Christ. It is God who gave Christ the authority to judge. So it's the judgment seat of God, and it's the judgment seat of Christ, because he's going to be there doing the judging. Now we keep going here, verse 12. So then, each of us will give an account of himself to God. Therefore, let us stop passing judgments on one another. Once again, this is not regarding doctrine. Although there might be cases, and certainly there will be, where you don't have to jump on every little thing that everyone says. Often that is just a stroking of one's ego. Well, hey, that's not right. Where somebody that maybe doesn't understand a whole lot and maybe says something that you know is doctrinally wrong. But again, try to look on his heart and then wait for the right opportunity. And then in the right way, with the right attitude. Remember, gentleness, epiakes. That's a good word to look at. It's only used, I think, 5 times in the Bible. And it gives you a good perspective of this kind of heart in dealing with people. Instead, make up your mind. Here's what you should do instead. Make up your mind not to put any stumbling block or obstacle in your brother's way. As one who is in the Lord Jesus, I am fully convinced that no food is unclean in itself. But, now see, so that was his heart, and he understood that there's nothing spiritually wrong with eating anything. Like in the Old Testament, certain things were prohibited by the spiritual Mosaic law. But if anyone regards something as unclean, then for him it is unclean. If your brother is distressed because of what you eat, you are no longer acting in love. You might call this heart before privilege. See, oh, let's say in the category of food, let's keep it in that. You know that you can eat everything, and God is there's no slap in the face of God to eat meat or not to eat meat. But this other guy, for whatever reason, thinks that it is. That doesn't mean you have to let him impose that on you. But if you go out with him, you know, get a steak some other time. Have a salad. You see? Just this kind of thing. It's this laying down your life. Then we have a pretty poor translation in the next sentence. Do not by your eating destroy your brother for whom Christ died. Okay? You eat a steak, he goes to hell. No. The word destroy means to tear down. That's one way. And the idea is of ruin, tear down, you know, put it in ruins, not annihilation. He belongs to Christ. How are you going to destroy him? So you don't tear him down. Do not allow, verse 16, what you consider good to be spoken of as evil. In other words, you know you can eat anything, but if you do that with certain people, then they're going to say you're wrong. So you give in. You're charitable on insignificant points. Why? Verse 17. For the kingdom of God is not a matter of eating and drinking, but of righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit. Because anyone who serves Christ in this way is pleasing to God and approved by men. Put your marker here, and we're going to elaborate on these last four or five verses in 1 Corinthians, starting in chapter 6. 1 Corinthians. 1 Corinthians relates to the doctrine of Romans. Now watch how Corinthians amplifies the truth of what we just read in about verses 14 to 18 there. 1 Corinthians 6:12. Let's read right starting here. Everything is permissible for me. Why? Because we're not under the law, so to speak. That's the point of this. But not everything is beneficial. In other words, it's legal, even though in the light of God's spiritual truth in this administration, it would be the wrong thing to do. But we're not under the law. That's the point. Everything is permissible for me, but not everything is beneficial. Everything's permissible for me, but I will not be mastered by anything. Food for the stomach and the stomach for food. But God will destroy them both. In other words, so food is not going to be the thing that runs my life. Neither is sex. Look at the next part of the verse. The body is not meant for sexual immorality, but for the Lord. And the Lord for the body. And this is all tied into present your bodies a living sacrifice. And there's a great truth tied in here as to why sexual immorality in the Bible is spoken of why spiritual unfaithfulness is spoken of in terms of sexual immorality, because it mirrors one's relationship to God. There's a wonderful book called The High Cost of Free Love by Al Hafner, H-A-F-F-N-E-R. Can't think of the publisher and I don't have it in front of me, but I highly recommend that you read it. I think every Christian should read it. Every single person, especially every parent, every teenager, because it just biblically sets forth the best I've ever seen, the heart of why and how sex is so magnificent in a marriage and such a ripoff outside of marriage. And this is a truth right here. You see, everything is not beneficial. This is not the right thing to do. Then we come over, so it goes on down. You can see that as you read on the rest of this chapter, flee from sexual immorality. And this book by Hafner sets forth the in-depth why and how this dilutes one's spiritual faithfulness to God. It's absolutely fabulous. Look at chapter 8, verse 1. Excuse me, chapter 8, verse 1. Now, it says, now about food sacrificed to idols. This is introducing this subject. Now that's food, and this ties to Romans. Now let me read you the note in the NIV study section here about this, because it'll help us understand what this is talking about in the context of the history in Corinth. Food sacrificed to idols, that is, offered on pagan altars. They used to sacrifice meat and stuff to their gods, you know, animals. And it says in here, meat left over from a sacrifice on the pagan altar might be eaten by the priests, eaten by the offerer and his friends at a feast in the temple, or sold in the public meat market. That was the three things that they did with the meat after they sacrificed them. You know, they cooked it, so to speak. Some Christians felt that if they ate such meat, they participated in pagan worship and compromised their testimony for Christ. Other Christians did not feel this way. So this is giving us a little background here. Now, about food sacrificed to idols. We know that we all possess knowledge. Knowledge puffs up, but love builds up. Love edifies. Knowledge puffs up. Sometimes you get all this knowledge, oh, I know this, and so forth. We are always thankful for right knowledge of the Scripture, but we don't let it puff us up into some egotistical attitude that because we know more. No, no, no. It's applying that knowledge with heart and love. Verse 2. The man who thinks he knows something does not yet know as he ought to know. But the man who loves God is known by God. Verse 4. So then, about eating food sacrificed to idols, we know that an idol is nothing at all in the world, and that there is no God but one. For even if there are so-called gods, whether in heaven or on earth, as indeed there are many, quote, quote, gods, and many lords running around all the pagan religions, yet for us, Christians, there is but, how many? One God, the whom? Father, makes it sort of plain. Out from whom all things came, and E-I-S, unto whom we live. And there is but one what? One Lord. And who is the one Lord? Jesus Christ. See the differentiation? What a great verse. Through whom all things came. God to Christ to us. And through whom we live. And if you take this verse apart, it's easier to spot in the King James and look at the prepositions of out from and through and unto. You see the great truth that, again, there's one mediator between God and man, the man, Christ Jesus. Verse 7. But not everyone knows this. Some people are still so accustomed to idols that when they eat food, they think of it as having been sacrificed to an idol. And since their conscience is weak, it is defiled. See, they feel badly, and then it throws them out of whack. But food does not bring us near to God. Guess what word that is? Peristemi, to stand beside. Food is not the way. It isn't what you eat or what you don't eat that stands you in good stead with God. We are no worse if we do not eat and no better if we do. Verse 9. Be careful, however, that the exercise of your freedom does not become a stumbling block to the weak. For if anyone with a weak conscience sees you who have this knowledge eating in an idol's temple, won't he be emboldened to eat what has been sacrificed to idols? And the note in the NIV says, at the site of ancient Corinth, archaeologists have discovered two temples containing rooms apparently used for pagan feasts where meat offered to idols was eaten. To such feasts, Christians may have been invited by pagan friends. Verse 11. So this weak brother for whom Christ died is destroyed, same word, torn down, messed up, by your knowledge. When you sin against your brothers in this way, it says it's a sin, and wound their weak conscience. See, you don't destroy them. You wound their weak conscience, and it says you sin against Christ. Another note in the NIV says on that verse about wounding their weak conscience, eating meat offered to idols when they feel it is wrong tends to blunt their consciences so that doing what is wrong becomes much easier. The result may be moral tragedy. I think that's valid insight to help us explain this. How would you wound their weak conscience? then they would go ahead and do something that they may have thought was wrong, and that would make it easier in another category where something really is wrong for them to do that. See the point? Verse 13. Therefore, he finishes it up, if what I eat causes my brother to fall into sin, I'll never eat meat again, so that I will not cause him to fall. Is that laying down your life? It certainly is. Chapter 10, 1 Corinthians 10, 23. And it says, here's a note on this whole subject here. When the people of Israel ate part of the sacrifice made at the altar, Leviticus 7, Deuteronomy 12, they participated in the worship of God, who established the sacrifices and whose altar it was. Likewise, when the pagans sacrificed, they did so to demons. See, and this is all about this eating of the meat and offer to idols. See, we can understand the background on this. And so this is the context of verse 14 and following. But we'll pick it up in 23. Everything is permissible. We read that in 6:12. But not everything is beneficial. Everything is permissible. Now, that doesn't mean that you have carte blanche from God to go into sexual immorality. That contradicts everything we read. The word permissible has to be understood in light of it's legal, in light of there being no specific law of don't do this, don't do that, don't do this kind of thing. Everything is permissible, but not everything is constructive. Nobody should seek his own good, but the good of others. Verse 25. Eat anything sold in the meat market without raising questions of conscience, for the earth is the Lord's and everything in it. If some unbeliever invites you to a meal and you want to go, eat whatever is put before you without raising questions of conscience. But if, see, because then you'd be mellow and, you know, you'd be able to identify with him and talk to him, and then he would see the goodness of God in your life as opposed to being cut off from you. Verse 28. But if anyone says to you, this has been offered in sacrifice, well, then don't eat it, both for the sake of the man who told you and for conscience' sake. The other man's conscience, I mean, not yours. For why should my freedom be judged by another's conscience? And in the NIV notes, eat whatever is put before you, it says, whether or not it might be meat sacrificed to idols, ask no questions. As long as the subject has not been brought up, you're free to eat the meat, even if it has been offered to an idol. But the next verse, if the meat has been identified as meat sacrificed to idols and you eat it, the man, whether believer or unbeliever, might think you condone or even are willing to participate in the worship of the idols the meat has been offered to. In eating meat that has publicly been declared to have been sacrificed to idols, you may offend the other man's conscience by causing him to think it is all right to eat meat sacrificed to idols, even though he has doubts about it. Or if he's an unbeliever, he may think that the Christian worships both God and a pagan idol. Now, you can apply this principle that's regarding the eating of meat here to current contemporary subjects. Verse 30, if I take part in the meal with thankfulness, why am I denounced? Because of something I thank God for. So whether you eat or drink or whatever you do, do it all for the glory of God. Do not cause anyone to stumble, whether Jews, Greeks, or the church of God. Even, he says, as I try to please everybody in every way. For I am not seeking my own good, but the good of many, so that they may be saved. Follow my example as I follow the example of Christ. That's where the chapter should end, with verse 1. Back to Romans 14. And we got through verse 18. So we're ready for verse 19. See, people are fragile. Really, we're all fragile. And sometimes it takes only a short time to tear someone down in something that he's built up, taking a long time to build up. So we just have to, and you ever seen a little sign, people are fragile, handle with prayer. something like that. Anyway, so you see this from verse 14 to 18, and then the things in Corinthians there. Let us therefore, verse 9, let us therefore make every effort to do what leads to peace and to mutual edification. Well, what do you think some of those things? The King James reads, let us follow after the things which make for peace. What is it talking about? Chapter 12, verses 1 and following would be a good place to start here. Let's make every effort to do what leads to peace. In other words, do what I've just told you in these last three chapters. Leads to peace and mutual edification. Verse 20, do not destroy, tear down, the work of God for the sake of food. All food is clean. In other words, there's nothing spiritually wrong with it. But it's wrong for a man to eat anything that causes someone else to stumble. See how Corinthians elaborates on that? It's better not to eat meat or drink wine or do anything else that will cause your brother to fall. And then the Corinthians, they had heard this doctrine, and they weren't doing it. That's why you see a lot of Romans in Corinthians. So whatever, verse 22, whatever you believe about these things, keep between yourself and God. Blessed is the man who does not condemn himself by what he approves. But the man who has doubts is condemned if he eats, because his eating is not from faith. He's not condemned by God. He condemns himself, and it throws off his spiritual equilibrium, you might say. Because his eating is not from faith, and everything that does not come from faith is sin. Because remember, faith comes by hearing. Disobeying the commandment of God is sin. That was the original definition. Now, the word here, approves, is our word dokimazo, from prove in Romans 12:2. And this is an important truth, because the King James reads, happy is the man who condemns not himself in that which he allows, or that thing which he allows. Blessed is the man who does not condemn himself by what he approves. The way that this verse has been twisted sometimes by Christians who want to tell you that you can basically do anything you want in terms of sexual immorality or other such aberrant to Scripture behavior, is that happy is the man who condemns not himself in that which he approves. And they say that, well, therefore, the standard for whether something is right or wrong is whether or not you condemn yourself for doing it. Well, that's not true because of the word dokimazo, which means to test against the standard. Blessed is the man who does not condemn himself by what he approves. Not just because, well, I feel I can do all these kinds of things. No. By what he tests against the standard of God's Word and determines to be okay. See it? That's what this is talking about. But the man who has doubts is condemned if he eats, because his eating doesn't come from faith. In his case, it wouldn't be based on the understanding of God's Word. And if he contradicts what that Word says, then it's sin. So chapter 14 is talking about, and it's in light of what we read in chapter 12, especially in the first part, and in how we can love each other and work together as Christians and knit our hearts together. And then it gives some very practical keys to not only avoid division, but promote great unity and heart in the body of Christ. Into Romans chapter 15, verse 1. Now watch how it'll pick up and follow right along with what we've been reading. Obviously, the God-breathed Word usually does that. We who are strong ought to bear with the failings of the weak. Now, that's just like how chapter 14 started. Accept him whose faith is weak. So We who are strong, those of us who, by the grace of God, may have a little clearer perspective on spiritual matters at this time than someone else, because life is a matter of growth, and faith is a matter of being weak or strong. And so, this is the way it is in life. There are those in the body of Christ stronger in their faith and understanding than others. So what do? They lord it over the others? No, they help, and not to please ourselves. Selfishness. You think about that word, of course, the key is self. Selfishness. It's sort of a deceitful lust, because it's like, I want this, or this is mine, or I'm getting this for me. But that'll really bless you. But self-orientation at the exclusion of others is not what blesses a believer. Service is the strongest elixir for your true nature. And the more we bear, B-E-A-R, the more we carry, the stronger we get. It's like lifting weights. You keep moving up in the amount of weight that you can pump. Verse 2. Each of us should please his neighbor for his good. Now, we just read something like that, didn't we, in Romans chapter 12, honor one another above yourselves. Philippians chapter 2 says something like that along about verse 3, let each esteem other better than himself. See, it's this hupotasso truth again. Ephesians 5:21, the right attitude of every Christian toward every other Christian. Each of us should please his neighbor for his good to build him up. For even Christ, look at our example, even Christ did not please himself. But, as it is written, Nome City, the insults of those who insult you have fallen on me. Verse 4. For everything that was written in the past was written to teach us. So what should we do? We ought to learn from it. So that through endurance and the paraclesis of the Scriptures, we might have hope. So we are to look to the Scripture, the Old Testament, the Gospels, these things that were written in the past. And basically this is speaking of that which was relevant to the administrations prior to the church administration that began on Pentecost. And it is these great truths that we see. And this goes back to the very first couple of verses in Romans where it said the gospel promised beforehand through his prophets in the Holy Scriptures regarding his son. See how this ties together? Gosh. And so, through endurance, hanging in there, and the encouragement, the comfort, the exhortation of the Scriptures, we might have hope. Verse 5, 6, and 7 are a little unit in sort of wrapping up the practical side of this great epistle, 12:1 to 15:7, as you see in your structure. And it says, may the God who gives endurance and encouragement, same as the verse before, endurance and encouragement comes through the Scriptures because they come from God. May the God who gives endurance and encouragement give you a spirit of unity among yourselves. And that's what the previous verses from 12:1 to 15:7 have been showing us how to do. A spirit of unity among yourselves as you follow Christ Jesus. He is always the one before our eyes. So that with one heart, and the text is really one mouth, you may glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Then it says, accept one another. That's way too weak. It's the Greek word proslambano. We're going to mark our place here and look at two very close references, but let's read the whole verse. It should be translated, take unto yourselves one another. Then, just as Christ, he didn't just accept you, He reached out and took you unto himself in order to bring praise to God. The King James translates it, receive one another.
Well, if you ever watch the National Football League or some game, football game, you have a receiver, a man who's supposed to catch a pass from the quarterback. So he runs out there, makes his move, turns around, and he sees this pigskin coming right at him. And so he just keeps his hands at his sides and hopes it will stick in his armpit. Not really. A receiver reaches out. As a matter of fact, if he's in a crowd, he has to muscle other people and even come back to the ball and grab onto it and hang on to it. So with my sports-oriented brain, that's how I think of this when I see this. Receive, take unto yourselves one another. And so you see how 5, 6, and 7, it's this endurance and encouragement of the Scriptures, that which comes from God, that helps give us a spirit of unity among yourselves as we follow Christ. So with one heart and one mouth, we may glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Look at Acts 17:5. Two references of this word proslambano in Acts chapters 17 and 18. Sort of like one good one and one bad one. Let's see here. Now, Acts 17:5, they came to Thessalonica, verse 1, went into the synagogue, verse 2, talked to them for 3 Sabbath days, verse 3, 4, some of the Jews were persuaded, and a whole bunch, verse 5. But the Jews, most of them, were jealous. So they rounded up some bad characters from the marketplace, formed a mob, and started a riot in the city. And then you can see it goes on. They went to Jason's house, searched for them, and so forth. Rounded up. The King James uses, took unto themselves certain lewd fellows of the baser sort. They took unto themselves. Now, this is the same word, proslambano. Now, think about it. Here are these highfalutin religious Jews who outwardly were very concerned with going through the motions. They would never generally, at least so publicly, associate with these, quote, bad characters. sounds like a poor actor. But anyway, they're really, these are vicious criminal elements. But they hired these hit men because they had a goal that burned in their hearts. Now, it wasn't that noble a goal. It was to kill the Apostle Paul. But the point of the word is that they set aside their prejudices and their preconceived notions of these people or whatever, and they reached out and took unto themselves and formed an allegiance, an alliance with these other people. It's showing you the heart of this word, proslambano. Look at 18:26. Acts 18:26. You may be familiar with this record of the great preacher Apollos in verse 24. And he's speaking boldly in the synagogue, verse 26. And you have Priscilla and Aquila, usually known as Aquila and Priscilla, whatever. They're the ones that started the grocery later on. A and P, never mind. When they heard, they invited him to their home and explained to him the way of God more adequately. The word invited, it says they took him unto themselves, I think, in the King James. But it's this word, proslambano. Now think about this. Here are Aquila and Priscilla. This man Apollos had quite a reputation, as you can see from the preceding verses, and perhaps they might have been a little apprehensive. He's the big preacher, and they say, "Excuse me, there's a little more to it than what you're sharing. Come on over to our house," and they explain to him the way of God more adequately. Now see what it says. They took him to their home. They opened their hearts and their home. They took him
unto themselves. What for? So they could explain the Word of God more perfectly, more accurately to him. Back to Romans 15. So you see, accept is way too weak there in verse 7. And so we are to reach out and take unto ourselves one another. Do we have an example, a standard by which to do it? Just as Christ accepted you. A simile, a comparison using like or as. Just as Christ received us. And how did Christ receive us? We've already read that. Romans chapter 5. When we were yet sinners, completely out of it, worthless, full of sin, Christ reached out and took us unto himself. Pretty good word there in Romans 15. And in the verses 5 and 6, we see this like passion with one heart and one mouth. It's a real long Greek word, homothumadon. This is the only use of it that's not in the book of Acts. There are 11 uses in Acts, and this one here, and it means with like passion, not just, yes, very good, and the guy next to you, yes, very good. No, 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 no. It's like passion. Again, like you see in a football game in the stands, people painting themselves of different colors and going without shirts and sub-zero temperature and all to demonstrate their passion for a cause. And a rather temporal one at that. We have an eternal cause. And so we who call upon the same Father should receive one another as Christ has received each of us. That's the basis for our fellowship. And our understanding, our standing in Christ, is the key to our reaching out to others. Then, on your structure, you see the little 15:8-12 administrational, and we'll read this section here now. For I tell you that Christ has become a servant of the Jews on behalf of God's truth, to confirm the promises made to the whom? Patriarchs. And I told you the number 2 in the Bible indicates confirmation. That's why most of the epistles open, grace to you and peace from God our Father, number 1, and from the Lord Jesus Christ, number 2. There is no pattern of 3 in the Scripture, like the Trinity, so-called, which is not a biblical term, but 3-in-1. There is no pattern like that. It's all 2. God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ, and that pertains all the way through Revelation, the next to the last chapter, or the last chapter where, again, I told you there are 2 seats on the throne. And it is the one who came to confirm the promises made by the first one. So, made to the patriarchs. So that, now who's the first patriarch that got any promise? Honest Abe, right? Remember? And Honest Abe in Genesis 12, 1, 2, and 3, that first reference, all nations of the earth shall be blessed. And so he again says that the Jews had the oracles and all this. Jesus came to bless them, but it was through the Jews, like we read in Romans 9, 10, 11, that the Gentiles got in. Because if it hadn't been for Christ coming from the lineage of Israel, there would be no salvation for the Gentiles. Verse 9. So that the Gentiles may glorify God for his mercy. Now we just read, with one heart and one mouth to glorify. He is appealing for unity in 5, 6, and 7. Remember I told you, all the way through the book of Romans, it's going to be Jew and Gentile. Keep in mind, Jew and Gentile, because that's who comprises the church of the body. And even in this little last part, we see another appeal for acceptance and unity. Now watch, it's going to be even clearer. So that the Gentiles may glorify God for his mercy. That's all the Gentiles had, was his mercy. The Jews had what we read in Romans 9, 4, and 5. Remember the law, the patriarchs, and ultimately Christ. And as it is written, another gnome, Therefore I will praise you among the Gentiles. I will sing hymns to your name. Remember, no secret in the Old Testament that the Redeemer would bless the Gentiles. You might say, and it's true, Romans is laying the doctrinal groundwork for Ephesians, the next doctrinal epistle. Again, verse 10, another gnome, rejoice, O Gentiles, with his people. And again, praise the Lord, all you Gentiles, and sing praises to him, all you peoples. And again, Isaiah, this time, specifies it, says, the root of Jesse will spring up, one who will arise to rule over the nations, and the Gentiles will hope in him. And of course, that one is Jesus Christ. So we have hope there in verse 12, and then in verse 13, may the God of hope, it's actually the hope, meaning the specific hope that we have, fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with hope in, not by, in the power of, no article the, Holy Spirit, the gift that God has given us. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with hope in the power of Holy Spirit. Verse 14, I myself am convinced, my brothers, that you yourselves are full of goodness, complete in knowledge, and competent to instruct one another. The word instruct is like that word. It's the same word, nouthateo. We saw it somewhere before. It means to put, to place in the mind. Nous and theteo, to put or place. To place in the mind, to set before one another, to help one another, like to parakaleo one another. I have written you quite boldly on some points, as if to remind you of them again, because of the grace God gave me to be a minister of Christ Jesus to the Gentiles, ministering, it then says in the King James, here it says, with the priestly duty of proclaiming the gospel of God so that the Gentiles might become an offering acceptable to God, sanctified by Holy Spirit. Now, see the word there, with the priestly duty. The King James translates it ministering, and it's a verb different than the other words like to serve or minister, and it means to minister as a priest. So this is a good translation, with the priestly duty. Why does he use this word in regard to his ministry to the Gentiles? It is used to show that through the finished work of Jesus Christ as declared in the gospel, promised afore, Romans 1:2, service to Gentiles is as sanctified as that to a Hebrew believer by a priest in Israel. It's another appeal for acceptance and unity between Jew and Gentile. Verse 17. Isn't that a neat point? Therefore I glory in Christ Jesus in my service to God. I will not venture to speak of anything except what Christ has accomplished through me in leading the Gentiles to obey God by what I have said and done. Remember, show and tell? That's a biblical principle. Say it and do it. By the power of signs and miracles, through the power of the Spirit. So from Jerusalem all the way around to Illyricum, I have fully proclaimed the gospel of Christ. I think that means he taught the mystery before he wrote it to the Ephesians. Verse 20. It has always been my ambition to preach the gospel where Christ was not known, so that I would not be building on someone else's foundation. Rather, as it is written, look at these gnomes, those who were not told about him will see, and those who have not heard will understand. This is why I have often been hindered from coming to you. But now that there is no more place for me to work in these regions, and since I have been longing for many years to see you. I plan to do so when I go to Spain. I hope to visit you while passing through and to have you assist me on my journey there after I have enjoyed your company for a while. You know what he's talking about? He's talking about he will come, he will share with them, enjoy their company, bless their lives, teach them the word, and you can look it up. To assist him on his journey means to give him a fresh donkey, a sack lunch, and a few bucks for donkey feed along the highway. That's what it's talking about, the biblical principle. It's all through the scriptures. Verse 25, now, however, I'm on my way to Jerusalem in the service of the saints there. For Macedonia and Achaia were badgered into making a contribution. No, no. They were pleased to make a contribution is the word koinonia, same word used for fellowship. That's part of fellowship, helping one another in a practical way. Somebody's starving, you say, well, I'll pray for you. Well, that's a little shallow. We ought to give them some food and then pray for them and then teach them the word and whatever. They were pleased to make a contribution for the poor among the saints in Jerusalem. They were pleased to do it, and indeed they owe it to them. For if the Gentiles have shared in the Jews' spiritual blessings, they owe it to the Jews to share with them their material blessings. It goes back, the essence of it, to Romans 11 about the root and the olive tree and all that. Remember that the Gentiles never would have gotten saved had it not been for the Jews. And that's the heart of this specific record here. Now, you have other sections like Galatians 6 and following. It says in the King James, let him who is taught in the word communicate, koinoneo, same word, with him that teaches in all good things. Of course, someone blesses you, then if it's according to your ability, then you bless them. So he's taking money to these poor people. And it says, verse 28, so after I have completed this task and have made sure that they have received this fruit. Now, why does he call it that? Because this is one way in which your life bears fruit when you share of your material abundance. And you will be rewarded for this. And Paul was concerned that this money get where it was going. I doubt if every dollar given to every charitable organization has gone exactly where the heart of the person who gave it thought it was going to go. But Paul was concerned about that. And that is the proper attitude. When you receive monies from people, they're giving you part of their life. I know if you send a gift to CES, I doubt if you won the lottery. I mean, maybe you did. But the point is, a little more godly way to get money, I guess, is to work and give 8 hours of your life one day, and then they give you whatever number of dollars you get for those 8 hours, and then you can help someone else. That's how you lay down your life, see? Verse 29. Well, I will go to Spain. I'll visit you on the way. I know that when I come to you, I will come in the full measure of the blessing of Christ. And that's pretty interesting, because even though when he did come to Rome, he came as a prisoner. But he was only a prisoner of men. And in his heart, he did come in the freedom and fullness of the blessing of Christ. Verse 30. I urge you, brothers, by our Lord Jesus Christ and by the love of the Spirit, to join me in my struggle by praying to God for me. I know that I appreciate your prayers if you're on our mailing list. And by the way, if you're not, just write us and we'll put you on. We write generally once every 3 months, and usually I put my itinerary in there. And I put that in there for a lot of reasons, one of them so you can pray for me. And I appreciate that. Verse 31, pray that I may be rescued from the unbelievers in Judea and that my service in Jerusalem may be acceptable to the saints there, so that by God's will I may come to you with joy and together with you be refreshed. That's why I look forward to traveling and getting out there and being with you and other believers. It's a real joy to me, especially when we get to go skiing during the day. Okay. Verse 33, the God of peace be with you all.
Amen. Chapter 16 is a very interesting section because after you get through the first two verses and then maybe three, then you have, I haven't counted them, I ought to do that sometime, all these names. The word greet is the word salute, and it means to extend a warm greeting toward. It implies some real heart there. And you got all these names through verse 15, from basically verse 3, verse 1, Phoebe, but then Aquila and Priscilla, and then from about verse 5 on to 15, you got a whole lot of names there. And I call this a roster of royalty, because we have individuals. Well, God wouldn't have had to give Paul the revelation to say this and mention all these names, Rufus and Phlegon, some of those guys. So Phlegon's from Krypton or somewhere. But anyway, I think these names are mentioned in light of the great doctrinal truth set forth in Romans, which shows, remember, the individual sinner taken from the depths of sin and iniquity and brought unto Christ Jesus and unto God. And that's what happened to each of those named. And just think about these people. We don't know them. We'll meet them someday, I guess, if we want to take time to talk to them in eternity. But each of them is a human being. But they so stood for God and blessed the life of the Apostle Paul that he remembers them in this God-breathed epistle. Verse 1. I commend to you our sister Phoebe, a servant of the church in Centuria. I ask you to receive her in the Lord in a way worthy of the saints, and give her any help she may need from you, for she has been a great help to many people, including me. I think this is just one example of the many biblical places where we see that women minister and teach very effectively. We just read about Aquila and Priscilla taking the great Apollos and teaching him. So it's very obvious in the scriptures that women minister. Now, maybe they don't always do it the same way men do, but so. And verse 3, greet Priscilla and Aquila, my fellow workers in Christ Jesus. They risked their lives for me, laid down their necks or something, it says in the King James. They risked their lives for me. Gee whiz. Look at the heart among these people. Not only I, but all the churches of the Gentiles are grateful to them. Why? Because that was to whom Paul ministered. Maybe if they hadn't risked their lives for him, he would have lost his and the Gentiles never would have heard. See, your life is a big deal. It's a bigger deal maybe than you think as you function in the body of Christ. And it affects a lot more people, both when you do God's will and if we don't do God's will. See, and no man is an island, remember? Verse 5. Now watch this truth. Greet also the church that meets at their what? House. I don't believe that the early church met primarily after the temple period in these big temples. I believe those were copied in later years as the word was diluted, that they were copied after the pagan temples. You know, like we want a big building like the pagans have. And I think the essence of what God wants is the church meeting in the home. It's warm, it's comfortable, it's edifying, as opposed to a stone-cold pew or something like that, maybe. That doesn't mean there are not big meetings, quote, quote. Big meetings are all through the Bible. They're very godly, too. But in a small home fellowship, everybody gets to share. Everybody gets to participate. Everybody gets his needs met. So then he says, from verse 5 to 15, say hi to all of these folks. And look at verse 7. They are outstanding among the apostles, and they were in Christ before I was. These people had been born again, and it says they've been in prison with him. Oh, man, this stuff is fantastic. And I'm going to skip to verse 16, but you can see he lists a few characteristics. Another woman who's worked very hard, who's been a mother to me. See? Verse 16, greet one another with a holy kiss. That was the way they used to greet, a kiss on the cheek.
All the churches of Christ send greetings. Verse 17, I urge you, brothers, to watch out for those, the King James says, mark those who cause divisions and put obstacles in your way that are, there. See, there's no period after that, in your way, because how would you know? Wouldn't be. It's got to be more than my opinion. The way to determine who these people are who cause division and put obstacles in your way by the standard of doctrine, see, that are contrary to the teaching is the word doctrine that you have learned. We have an unfailing yardstick of truth, the written word of God. And he says, keep away from them. First you confront them. And if they refuse to change and you see their hearts have been twisted to total, just be completely evil, that they don't care, then you keep away from them because 1 Corinthians, hey, that relates to Romans, remember? 15:33, I think it is, says, evil associations corrupt good morals in the King James. And if you look up evil and associations and corrupt and good and morals, you'll see a whole lot about what that verse means. Those are five good words right in one verse. Five in one. Verse 18. For such people are not serving our Lord Christ, but their own appetites. There's so much truth in these verses. By smooth talk and flattery, they deceive the minds of naive people. And it just gets worse and worse. Remember, they wax worse and worse. People are either being transformed or they are conforming. Remember, those were in the continual tense. You're either going to pick up momentum one way or the other. That's why we want to go in the right direction. Verse 19. Everyone has heard about your obedience, so I am full of joy over you. See how he edified those people and built them up? And he says, hey, you guys are doing great. And everybody's heard about it. But I want you to be wise about what is good and innocent about what is evil. You don't need to experience evil to know good. That's a fallacy. Verse 20. The God of peace will soon crush Satan under your feet. Soon. Next week? I don't know, but from God's point of view, it is soon. But the reason he says it, and it's like that other verse, it's slipping my mind now, but it was in the last tape, and I said I'd mention it again. It is to emphasize the aspect of eternity as compared to the temporal groaning of this life. The God of peace will soon crush Satan, compared to however long it is from now until he crushes Satan under our feet, that's nothing compared to eternity. See that? The grace of our Lord Jesus be with you. Timothy, my fellow worker, sends his greetings to you. Now, this is pretty great. Verse 20. The God of peace is going to crush Satan under your feet. And you know what will happen when that happens? Peace. Peace through strength. Same principle we've seen. He's the God of peace, so he's not going to put up with the devil. Verse 21. Timothy, my fellow worker, sends his greetings to you, as do Lucius, Jason, and Sosipater, my relatives. I, Tertius, who wrote down this letter, greet you in the Lord. He was what they called the amanuensis, the secretary. Paul dictated, this guy wrote. Gaius, whose hospitality I and the whole church here enjoy, sends you his greetings. Erastus, who is the city's director of public works, and our brother Quartus, send you their greetings. It's just interesting. People in different walks of life. We're all members of the body of Christ. And then come these last three verses, which are pointing us toward Ephesians, where the awesome truth of the mystery is expanded and clarified. So it reads, verse 25, now to him who is able to establish you by my gospel and the proclamation of Jesus Christ according, I don't think there should be a comma after Jesus Christ, and the proclamation is the preaching of Jesus Christ according to, kata, by what standard? The preaching of Jesus Christ according to the revelation of the mystery. Not the preaching of Jesus Christ according to the Old Testament or according to the gospel period, but the preaching of Jesus Christ according to the revelation of the mystery, hidden for long ages past, but now revealed and made known through the prophetic writings by the command of the eternal God, so that all nations might believe and obey Him. To the only wise God be glory forever through Jesus Christ. Amen. So be it. And all we saw was a little bit about the mystery in Romans chapter 12. But later on, and let's close in Ephesians chapter 2, Paul wrote by revelation from the same author of Romans. He wrote Ephesians. And this great truth of the mystery is the ultimate reason why, as Romans stated, Jesus Christ was born of the seed of David according to the flesh. This is why, when we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. This is why He was declared to be the Son of God with power by the resurrection from the dead. This is why you and I were called and justified, and why we will be glorified. This is why we can walk in newness of life and serve in newness of spirit, functioning as members in particular of the body of Christ and knitting our hearts together in love. Ephesians 2:11-22 very aptly capsulizes and clarifies some of the truths that we saw in Romans. Verse 11. Therefore remember that formerly you who are Gentiles by birth and called uncircumcised by those who call themselves the circumcision, that done in the body by the hands of men, remember that at that time you were separate from Christ, excluded from citizenship in Israel and foreigners to the covenants of the promise, without hope and without God in the world. But now, in Christ Jesus, you who once were far away have been brought near through the blood of Christ. For He Himself is our peace, who has made the two, what two? Jew and Gentile, one, and has destroyed the barrier, the dividing wall of hostility. And in the temple, they had a wall between the court of the Gentiles and the court of the Jews. And the Gentiles weren't allowed to go in. And then, of course, they had another wall between the court of the Jews and the Holy of Holies, where even the Jews weren't allowed to go, only the high priest, once a year, and with the sacrifice of blood. Verse 15, how did He do it? By abolishing in His flesh the law with its commandments and regulations. His purpose was to create in Himself one new man out of the two, thus making peace. The message in Ephesians and Colossians is that Jesus Christ is creating the new man, the body of Christ. Don't have time to get into all that, but that'll help you understand that Colossians 1:15-18 in there if you really work that. Verse 16. And in this one body, to reconcile both of them to God through the cross, by which He put to death their hostility. He came and preached peace to you who were far away, Gentiles, and peace to those who were near, Jews. For through Him, we, both Jew and Gentile, have access, that same word, the introduction to the Father by one Spirit. Consequently, verse 19, you are no longer foreigners and aliens, but fellow citizens with God's people and members of God's household, built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, with Christ Jesus Himself as the chief cornerstone. In Him, the whole building is joined together and rises to become a holy temple in the Lord. And in Him, you too are being built together to become a dwelling or a dwelling place in which God lives by His Spirit. And it's all available because of the finished work of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. God bless you. I love you very much. This is the end of this side of the tape, this tape, and the seminar.